Good evening, Respected Chairpersons, distinguished guests and delegates. At the very outset, I'd like to thank the organizer, mainly Dr. Jayant Pandasa and Dr. Anuj Maheshwari sir, for giving me the opportunity to talk in front of this August gathering. Now, I have been allotted a little difficult job of need to talk on how to decide drugs in pregnancy in primary care setting. So without any ado, now, what is a pregnancy is basically a very difficult physiological situation where when you should have a sufficient concern once you write some drug, because it may cause some potential teratogenicity in the fetus, some physiological changes in mother that can also be seen in pregnancy. And because of these physiological changes, there may be some change in the pharmacokinetics of the drug, which may again cause injury or damage to the fetus as well as in the mother. So we know the two important history. One is thalidomide crisis that occurred in 1960, and another is with the effect of diethyl silvestrol, which occurred in 1971. So if you see the physiology of pregnancy, now after the fetus get in the first stage, once they get fertilized, now after that, within 5 to 7 days, they get implanted in the uterine body and they starts development of the placenta. Now, placenta is, it takes very important part to transfer the waste from the fetus. And the placenta, it also, it maintains the maintains and nourishes the baby by enabling the transfer of oxygen, carbon dioxide, amino acid, fats, vitamins and minerals from the mother's blood. Now, defect in the fetus usually depend on at what stage you are using the phytotoxic drug, and also depends on the strength and the dose of the drug that we're using. If you see the development of the fetus, actually the initial phase is around 8 weeks, the fetus is known as embryo. And the period between the 3 weeks to 8 weeks is the vital, where there is actually organogenesis occur in the development. And during this stage, if you use some phytotoxic drug, they will cause miscarriage, birth defect, permanent or subtle defect in the fetus. But after the 8 weeks of period, actually the period is of growth and maturation. So there is no organogenesis at that moment. So if you use some drug at that particular time of development, they may cause some defect in the growth and function of the normally developing organ, but it will not cause any congenital malformation to the fetus. Now, if you see the pharmacokinetics in pregnancy, there is actually around 30 to 50% of the volume gain in the mother. At the same time, there'll be an increase in cardiac output and GFR at the same time. So there'll be lower circulatory volume of some of the important drugs and increased volume of distribution of some of the drugs. One important one is the anticonvulsant. That's why actually we may have to increase the dose of anticonvulsant during the pregnancy period. And in pregnant female, actually, there is some lower amount of albumin than in comparison to the non-pregnant lady. And that's why there is high volume of distribution of protein-bound drugs. Again, anticonvulsant is one of the important issues. Unbound drugs, again, once they remain unbound, they are excreted more easily and rapidly via the kidney and the liver. And that is another important issue. Now, a little bit about the placenta. Now, the placenta is actually the functional unit between the fetal and the maternal blood. And it functions, it has got plenty of function. It maintains the nutrition, expiration, metabolism, excretion, and endocrine function to the fetus. And if a drug need to cause a teratogenic effect on the fetus, that had to cross to the placenta. And that's why it depends upon some of the chemical characteristic of the drug and the environment. So those are the protein binding capacity, pH difference between the two environments, lipid solubility, molecular weight of the drugs. These are the important area that we have to concentrate. Now, if you see here, there are two zones. One is from the fetal side and another is from the mother side. Now, in a pregnancy, there is actually low albumin, as I've said, in the mother environment. And that's why there is more chance of development of the free drugs in the mother, which can transmit through the placenta to the fetus and can damage to the fetus. Same way, there is some amount of change in the environment in the form of media. So mother is having less acidic media and fetus is having relatively more acidic media. And that's why if we use some weak base as drug, they may transmit through the placenta and may cause some metabolic changes in the fetus. Again, some drugs are lipid soluble, and this lipid soluble drug, they can easily passed through the placenta and got damaged to the fetus. So as the low molecular weight drug, though having small in size, they can pass through the placenta easily and they can damage to the fetus and cause, you know, fetal toxicity. So if you see the pregnancy and drug, we need to have a good drug which should be safe, efficacious, and rationally. Otherwise, it is better to avoid drug as much as possible during pregnancy, which may otherwise may cause harm to the fetus. Some conditions are always there, which may still remain in pregnancy because they may have some chronic disease like hypertension, asthma, or maybe epilepsy, which may be a chronic disease, may continue with the pregnancy. So you'll have to use the drug. And sometimes some disease may exacerbate. I'm giving an example of a migraine, which may exacerbate during pregnancy. So these are the situations where we'll have to use the drug, but this may affect the mother as well as the fetus. Vitamin, minerals, iron, and dietary supplementations. These are necessary for the development of the growing fetus as well as the mother. And there are some studies which has been seen that more than 90% of the pregnant lady, they are taking some drug, either in the form of prescription or from OTC. So this is a big concern. But what is more important is that the most, you know, studies in the randomized controlled trial, pregnant ladies are excluded from the study because of some ethical issues. Now we are at some difficult situation. Now, once we need to prescribe, we don't have much of evidence. The amount of evidence that we are having basically on this, some case studies, maybe some epidemiological observational studies, and maybe some animal studies. We don't have any randomized controlled trial. So we'll have to rely on that particular trials. Now, if you see it, around 2 to 3% of the all birth defect may be because of use of different drugs in pregnancy. There are lots of situations where we may have to use drug in pregnancy. That may be aches and pains, may have nausea, vomiting, development of edema, maybe urinary tract infection, maybe respiratory tract infection, maybe a GI upset, or maybe a continuation of the chronic ailment in the form of hypertension or so, or maybe a pregnancy-related issue like PIH or gestational diabetes mellitus or so on. Now, how this drug actually affect the fetus in three different ways. Either it can directly injure the fetus and may cause, you know, birth defect or fetal death. It may also cause effect on the placenta in the form of vasoconstriction, which may cause reduced supply of oxygen and nutrient to the fetus and may have underdevelopment or the poor development of the fetus. Or sometimes it may also cause constriction or contraction of the smooth muscle of the uterus, which may cause preterm labor or preterm delivery. So FDA, way back in 1979, has, you know, designed some, you know, category of the drug A, B, C, D, and X. A is well proved that these drugs are good, safe in pregnancy. B is proved in animals, actually, that no definite data, but they're still taken as a safe drug, B. But C and D, these are actually, you need to have some, you know, decision which drug will give a beneficial effect to the, whether it is really important to use in that particular patient or not. And X, we should not use the drug. Rather, these are contraindicated. Now, there are lots of drugs that we need to use in the day-to-day practice that may be analgesics, which is common required. But the important is the safety is basically on acetaminophen or phenacetin, which is a safer drug. Aspirin can be used in lower dose, but it should be a query in high dose. So as an antiemetics, these group of four drugs are said to be safer in using during pregnancy. Antibiotics are again another important area. Penicillin, cephalosporin, macrolides. These three groups of drugs are said to be safe in pregnancy. Other drugs like amikacin and other things that we'll have to consider the risk and benefit ratio and we'll consider. Antiemetic, metronidazole is said to be safer. Antihelminthic, these are the safer drugs that can be used in pregnancy. Antitubercular drug, controversial zone, and ethambutol may be said to be a little safer in comparison to the other drugs. Now, vitamins are like A, B, C, and folic acid are safe. It's group A, so it can be used very easily. In hormone replacement, thyroxine is the safest, but androgen and estrogen is preferred to be avoided. These are contraindicated. Hydroxyprogesterone and medroxyprogesterone, it's a controversial area. We may have to consider some time, not necessarily. Now, that means if you use this drug like vitamin A and its derivative, they may cause abortion, malformation in the fetus. ACE inhibitors should not be used because they may cause renal damage, may cause decrease in amount of the amniotic fluid and deformity in the face, limbs, and lungs. And warfarin is, again, may cause fetal warfarin syndrome and fetal malformation. And estrogen and androgen, they may cause genital malformation. Antithyroid drugs, again, this should not be used. They may cause overactive thyroid in fetus. And if you use in the first trimester, methimazole and carbimazole may also cause aplasia cutis. And that's why it is not preferred in the first trimester. But propylthiouracil is a safer drug during pregnancy. Now, anticonvulsant, as you all know, probably most of the anticonvulsant are not very suitable actually during pregnancy. But carbamazepine may cause, you know, risk of a birth defect. Phenytoin may cause fetal hydantoin syndrome, risk of bleeding after birth. And sodium valproate is most toxic drug during pregnancy, may cause neural tube defect in the form of cleft lip, cleft palate, abnormal heart, face, and abnormal organ genesis in abdomen. Antidepressant, predominantly I'm taking one, lithium is very toxic and may cause, you know, cardiac anomalies in the form of Epstein's anomaly, hypotonia in the baby, and diabetes insipidus. Now, there are a list of drugs actually which are contraindicated during pregnancy. NSAID is one which may cause delay in the labor and premature closure of the ductus arteriosus. Tetracycline may cause permanent straining of the teeth and may cause poor bone growth in the fetus. Chloramphenicol may cause gray baby syndrome. Fluoroquinolone nowadays still used, but it may cause, you know, fetal cartilage damage. And streptomycin, kanamycin group of drug may cause ototoxicity. Antineoplastic drug may cause growth retardation, underdevelopment of the lower jaw, cleft palate, so on and so forth. Now, what we do in primary care, it's a tricky situation. I'm giving you an example of, say, 34-year lady with 6 weeks of amenorrhea, came with history of fever, 3 days with cough dry in nature, associated with aches and pain and anorexia. Examination finding was apparently normal, except some amount of conjunctival chemosis. They thought it to be a viral, and we can start with paracetamol, dextromethorphan as a cough suppressant, which is said to be safe in pregnancy and may use a vitamin C. But after 5 to 7 days, the patient came back again with persistent fever and cough with a mucopurulent expectoration, and chest examination shows some amount of crackles. So we thought the rat is again, the COVID is negative. Now we thought maybe a secondary bacterial infection, and we have started with antibacterial azithromycin and along with salbutamol inhalation. So ultimately the patient gets some amount of recovery, but the patient was under cover. Now another issue is, suppose a 35 years old lady who is a diagnosed type 2 diabetes mellitus was on metformin 500 twice daily and presented with amenorrhea for 3 months. And she is also a diagnosed case of hypothyroidism, getting thyroxine 50 microgram. Now on examination, other examination finding was absolutely fine, with sugar and creatinine was also normal. Now, what we did is actually that we continued with the metformin as the patient was in metformin and the patient was absolutely maintaining blood sugar levels. So we continued with the metformin. But thyroxine, you need to increase the dose immediately once the patient conceived. We have to increase the dose by 30 to 50%. So increase to 75 microgram and added a folic acid. But once we do a repeat, you know, sugar analysis after 4 weeks, there is high amount of sugar. But though the TSH was absolutely on the target. Now we started with insulin now. Now, hypertension in pregnancy is again another common association. I'm going in brief. It may be associated with the preeclampsia, whether it new onset hypertension after 20 weeks of gestation, associated with proteinuria, where actual the treatment is delivery of the fetus and the placenta, but may take the help of labetalol, hydralazine. These are the safe drug. May have to take the help of magnesium sulfate. And the chronic essential hypertension is another association where the drug of choice is actually labetalol, nifedipine, and methylloprednisolone can be used. So this is one scenario of 27-year-old lady hypertensive who was actually controlled on chlorthalidone 12.5 milligram. Now have a missed period for last 7 days. Now it has been seen that the BP was still high. Again, chlorthalidone is not safe during pregnancy. So we have converted it to labetalol 100 milligram TDS. Again, we rechecked the blood pressure after 2 weeks. Blood pressure is still high, not yet up to the target. So we have added with nifedipine 10 milligrams twice daily. Now the blood pressure was controlled. Had it not been in control, we could have another option to use methylloprednisolone we can use in that particular patient. Now, another patient, a 22-year lady with bronchial asthma needing SOSBCs of salbutamol and beclomethasone, presented with 3 months history of amenorrhea and with increased shortness of breath. Now, what we did is we started with regular budesonide 200 milligram microgram twice daily inhalation and salbutamol SOS, and patient got some amount of improvement. Now, what is the relationship in bronchial asthma? It is said that the short-acting inhaled bronchodilators, anti-leukotrienes, and inhaled steroids are safe, like budesonide, these are said to be safe. And if you sometime may have to use oral steroid, then prednisone is better safe drug during treatment of bronchial asthma and during pregnancy. Another case of 20-year-old lady presented to the OPD with 5 months amenorrhea with dyspepsia. It's very common association, dyspepsia. Now, we started with ranitidine 150 milligram twice daily with antacid, and patient got some amount of improvement. What I emphasize is that because this is a very common situation, the base drug is probably the antacid, but it should not contain sodium bicarb, magnesium trisilicate, because magnesium trisilicate is responsible to cause hypotonia in the baby and may cause nephrolithiasis. Sucralfate may be added if there is any feature of erosion or something like, because they are less absorbed. And H2 receptor blocker would have been a better choice. Ranitidine is a better choice. PPI nowadays is preferred, but it still may cause hypospadias in some cases. Neurological issues like epilepsy is again a common situation where actually most of the drug are toxic, you know, or anticonvulsants are toxic, but these are the preferable, relatively less toxic drug, but we have to increase the dose of the drug. And sodium valproate, we should try to avoid as much as possible in pregnancy. Migraine, almost all drug will have to stop, including triptan, ergot derivative, TCA should be avoided. What we use, we can use SOS basis of high dose acetaminophen to control the headache. Now, in summary, I'll just sum up that pregnancy is basically a complex physiological process. There is lots of change of pharmacokinetic and pharmacodynamics of the drugs, and should always try to avoid the phytotoxic drug to the pregnant lady. Should be always judicious, and minimal use of drug during pregnancy is the best way to prevent phytotoxicity because of the drug. Thank you. Thank you very much for your kind and patience hearing.